What's the difference between an administrator account and a limited user account? Hi, everyone. I'm Leo Notenboom for askleo.com. So Windows actually includes two types of accounts, but three types of accounts. It gets confusing pretty quick. There's an administrator account, which I actually call something else, and I'll describe that in a minute. A standard user, sometimes called a limited user. And there's also a third account, which is also referred to as administrator. But the administrator account isn't really the administrator account, and all the accounts can do administrator-like things. The difference between them all is just how easy it is to do those administrative things. Let's look a little deeper. So, administrator accounts. This is the account that you probably have created when you set up Windows in the first place. I call this an administrator capable account. Now, since we're going to make some changes to an account that is administrator capable, let's have a look at Windows 11 right now. What I'm doing is firing up the settings program, and I'm going directly to accounts. Then we have to scroll way down to find other users. Other users then lists all of the login accounts for this machine. I have two. The first one is, of course, my account, the currently signed in account. That is an administrator capable account. This other account is also an administrator capable account, but it's a local account. It's not a Microsoft account. If I want to change the account type, I can do that. Change the account type allows me to change between administrator and standard user. Now, realize that only administrator capable accounts or administrator accounts can make this change. If you're signed in using a user account or limited user account, then the only thing I think you might be able to do is demote yourself from administrator to user, but you might not even be able to do that. It's administrator accounts that are capable of making this change. So let's take a look at just what the difference is between this administrator capable account that we're looking at and the so-called user account. It boils down to the UAC prompt. So what I'll do right now, since we're in our administrator capable account, is I'm just going to run the admin version of Terminal. And right away, we get the familiar UAC prompt. I'll go ahead and click yes to run it, and that's all it took, right? An administrator capable account needs only to click yes when UAC is brought up. All right, let's demote this account, this local account, to a standard user. That's all it took. This account now is a local account and it is not administrator. The next thing I'll do is sign into this machine as that account. So I'll sign out of my current account, choose the local account to sign in as, and sign in. And here we are back in that account. You can see that if I go to settings, accounts, you can see that it's Leon, my local account. And in fact, of course, it's bugging me to sign into a Microsoft account because Microsoft. Now, one of the things you'll notice is that because this is not an administrative account, the whole concept of other users here isn't even listed. So there's nothing that this account, this limited account, can do. That's one of the changes. There are some features that may or may not be available depending on what kind of an account you're logged into. But that's not the biggest difference, or at least not the most commonly encountered difference. If I right-click on the Start button, and this time click again on Terminal Admin, this time I get a different UAC dialog. It's not enough for me to just click OK. I need to somehow prove that I know something about the administrative account. Any administrative account will do, but an administrative account that is also on this machine. That way, only people you trust are given whatever this information might be so that they could do this. If they know the PIN, for example, in this case, they can do something at the administrative level. If they don't know the PIN, which is what you would want an untrusted user to be, they can't do anything. There's nothing they can do. They can try different ways. It'll ask for passwords and that kind of stuff, but this is all information that your limited user, the one you're trying to protect, doesn't have. You and whomever you choose to give this information to will still be able to do administrative level stuff. So, for example, if I say no, well, that's it. I can't do what I just tried to do. On the other hand, if I run it again, and this time go ahead and type in the PIN for the other account, boom, it just works. I was able to, with a limited account, do an administrative task because I knew the PIN or the password of at least one of the administrative accounts on this machine. Fantastic. Now, that's the accounts that you're probably most familiar with. I'm going to reboot again or sign out again, and this time I'm going to sign back in as an administrator level account because what I need to do next is show you this other administrative account. So far, we've had what I call the administrator capable account. It's typically running only as a limited user, but when you fire up the UAC, all you have to do is hit OK. If you're a limited user account or a standard account, then if you want to do something administrative, when that dialog pops up, you have to provide more information, more confirmation that you are in fact authorized to do administrative level stuff on this machine. But there's another account. There's another administrative account on this machine. This is what I call the secret administrator account. And the reason it's secret is because it's not enabled by default. Normally, you just get that first account that you created when you set up Windows and any other accounts you choose to add to your machine later. There is still an administrator account whose name actually is administrator that you can enable to access your machine. So I'm going to do that. Naturally, this does take doing a command in an administrative level command prompt. The command is net user administrator slash active colon yes. This turns on the currently inactive administrator account. And yes, later, if you want to turn it off again, which I'm actually going to recommend you do, just change the yes to a no. We'll do that. It's very boring. There's no real interesting activity here. Not a lot has changed. We'll go ahead and sign out. And now you'll notice there's a third account listed here. It's called administrator. I'm going to sign into that. You'll notice that it's not asking for a password. By default, the administrator account has no password. That's one of the reasons you want it disabled by default. Now, since this is the first time I've run this account on this machine, we're going through the Windows out-of-box experience to set a few things up. And here we are in Windows running as the administrator. If I take a look at settings, you can see it has me listed there as administrator local account. If I take a look at accounts, you'll see that, in fact, there is the other users option, which lists both the administrator account, the Microsoft account that I set up this machine with originally, and this local user account that I have enabled as well. I'm going to use this as an opportunity to change the account type of that local account because I want that to be administrator. Great. It's an administrator. What's the difference? If I right-click on the start menu and click on, in this case, Windows PowerShell admin, there was no UAC. When you're signed in to the real administrator account, you have administrator privileges constantly, the entire time. Now, like I said, I'm going to suggest you turn this or disable this account. If you choose not to, please make sure to set a password. I'm going to go here to Settings, Accounts, Sign In Options. And of course, there's a lot of options here. I'm just going to go ahead and set a password on this account. The next time you sign in, you'll have to use the password. That basically secures the administrator account, the default administrator account, so that you do actually need to know something about it in order to sign in. Like I said, I generally recommend you disable this real administrator account because it's just too risky. You can do everything you need with the standard administrator capable account. It's just that you'll be bothered or annoyed by UAC periodically. That annoyance is worth it, because if for some reason malware gets on your machine, if you are running as the true administrator, malware can do anything it wants immediately. If, on the other hand, you're running as the administrator capable account, then you'll at least see a UAC pop-up. Maybe you won't expect it. Maybe you'll not understand what program is asking for the privilege. It's something that will cause you to pause and take a closer look at exactly what's going on when you don't expect the UAC prompt. So, that's the three accounts. The real administrator that is generally disabled, and I recommend stay disabled. The administrator capable account, which is probably the account you created when you set up your machine. If you get a UAC, you'll only need to click OK. And the limited user or standard user account, where when you get a UAC prompt, you'll need to provide some form of credential to prove you still have administrator capabilities. I hope that was helpful. For comments, for updates, for links to related topics and more, visit askleo.com/172886. I'm Leo Notenboom, and this is askleo.com. Thanks for watching.